Welcome to Baku in Azerbaijan for the final qualifying session of this 2014 season in the Blancpain Sprint Series. Championships to be decided this weekend, and it's all going to take place on a street circuit with 30 cars. As you can see, it was wet, it is drying, but with the air temperature only being 15.4 degrees, the dry line is getting dry, but offline it's continuing to be wet as you see parts of this Azerbaijan street circuit that makes its way down the dual carriageway, a hairpin, back up, then into the old town for a little bit before heading back out onto the dual carriageway, down to the hairpin at turn 10, back up around the final corner and across the line. The circuit length, 3.8 kilometers long, and it's got 13 corners on it this season. It's slightly modified, so slightly shorter than the venue we were at last season. As far as the championship is concerned, coming into this final round, it's Maximilian Goetz who's leading the way. 142 points, that's 27 clear of Jeroen Bleekemolen and Harry Prochek. Max Buch, because he missed one race in Slovakia, can't win the title. My name is Jack Nichols. Alongside me in the commentary box is John Watson. Down in the pit lane, we have David Addison. And John, I think we're in for an exciting qualifying session with 30 cars out there all vying for pole position.
Yes, and the key is to find the clear lap, more so maybe than at any time during a number of the last few races, because if you stray off that drying line, you will find yourself losing a lot of time, and you could even find yourself even getting close contact with rather sort of, I mean, you see they were just simply overrunning under brakes into turns one and two, and that's just an illustration of how easy it is even on the drying line to get it all wrong. And that was not a very bright maneuver, particularly
Mark Basseng,
somebody who should know better. Anyway, the nature of the racetrack, stay on the line. If you get offline, you might as well stop the lap because you will lose time. And it is unforgiving from this point here, out of turn four and five up through six, seven. This is the old part of the town. It's narrow. The track surface in the dry is slippery, so you've got to be careful. Into turn seven, easy to overrun. Go down the escape road, then into turn eight, a very tight, slow right-hand hairpin, which brings you back on to the dual carriageway.
There you can see the skyline of Baku in the background. This is the second year that we have raced here in this part of town, and it's been slightly modified. So there was a chicane here last season, but that's been ditched, and so it's a full speed flat out run down towards this hairpin. This is Nicky Mayer-Mounoff we're watching, and he's just had to go offline, and as a result slithers wide, and that's going to ruin his lap as he tried to get past the Callaway Corvette.
He's managed to sort of scratch his way around the outside of turn 10 up the hill into this almost, you know, it's barely flick the wrist one way, flick back the other way, and then the magnificent long turn 13, which in dry conditions is flat, but you can see just coming through midway the edge of the cars way out on the right hand side of the track where there is still dampness on the surface. So you've got to be careful. Again, look, Mickey Mayer, he's made a mistake into brake under turn one and turn two. And team driver Marcus Winkelhock, well, he's watching that and thinking, well, he should have known by now. He's done one flying lap, he's on another lap that could have seen him improve. Let's look again what Mayer Mellenhoff was trying to do. This is coming down the hill into turn 10. Damp track, the dark track is damp, the lighter colour track, then back onto the drive in a track, patchy. Well, that's even more wet than anything else. So it's three grades of wetness. You've got wet, almost wet, and almost dry. Or dry, but it's not almost wet.
I hope that's clear for you joining us for this qualifying session ahead of the final race of the season. There is the Porsche of the 31 team, which is track speed Porsche, and it is currently Richard Westbrook at the wheel as he comes across the line to go third quickest. Quickest man so far is that BMW right up behind him, the Schubert Motorsports BMW. Jens Klingman at the wheel, a newcomer to the racing this weekend because he's filling in for Thomas Jaeger, who can't make the race here in Baku. He's partnering Dominic Baumann. There is the championship leading car, number 84, Max Goetz, and he's one and two.
And he's got the headlights flashing and everybody. Major, major impact indeed. We don't know whether he's, I think we may, there's a black tire mark against the wall further down the racetrack. And that is an illustration of what goes wrong if you happen to be offline.
He's the moving right around rear. Inside the
well,
cockpit.
He's fine, he's okay. I mean, these things are very, very securely manufactured. I mean, there's so much safety, but bodywork literally all over the racetrack, right on the line as you'll be coming through this very long final turn 13.
Well, that's quite a... let's see if we can figure out where...
It started much earlier. Look, Well, that's the end of it. Now, what's happening here? Oh, there's the wheel we see on the right-hand side of the screen. There's a mark. I noticed a mark on the wall about maybe 50 or 60 yards before the cars come to a standstill, which I imagine that's where the impact, which is ripped. Look, at a mark. He's taken a bit of concrete and absolutely eaten it. And, I mean, we may have a slightly longer delay while they want to try and get that piece of concrete barrier. That's very, very heavy impact indeed.
And that's what we were talking about with, you know, the moment you get slightly offline in these sorts of conditions with no margin for error, you're going to be in a little bit of trouble.
Did I say if you get offline? I think I might have been, and I'm sure everybody in the pit lane was told that, you know, don't get offline. But you never know. We need to see maybe what led to this particular occurrence, because we're seeing the end product of it, and it's a heavy, heavy impact indeed. And there would be a very bruised Vincent Abril getting out of the car. When you have an impact of that magnitude, elbows, knees, they get really banged together or banged against something in the chassis, normally a roll cage, you can see that he is hurting. And even something as fundamental as the seat belts, the impact that your body sustains through the shoulder straps, the harness, not least of all the crutch straps. And, well, sort of the adrenaline's still there. And the shock, I think, is maybe the biggest factor that he's having to deal with and trying to be rational. But there's the beginning.
Well,
that's further down the track.
The interesting thing now, just to turn it on a championship perspective, is that Vincent Abril and Mateusz Lisowski are leading
silver
the
cup.
Silver
exactly.
Cup.
Exactly, I'm just about to say that.
By a comfortable margin over David Fuminelli and Stefano Colombo. So if they can't get that car fixed, then Colombo and Fuminelli have it's an outside chance that Fuminelli and Colombo have, but this is very good news for them.
I think that I'd always be optimistic in this context and say that they will have this car repaired for tomorrow, but there are two races on Sunday. And it's going to be a very, very long night for the WRT team. They will have, I'm sure, all the equipment that they need. It's just a question of whether there's any damage that is more than what we might see, if there's any structural damage to the actual, the engine bay and everything that attaches to that. So heavy impact indeed. Just going back to what we saw this morning when the fastest lap had been set by Alessandro Zanardi at a 1:32.09. Quickest lap from Kleeman in the BMW, 1:34.6. So about 2.6 seconds away. The speed of that impact was substantial.
Yeah.
Just looking at the amount of damage to the barrier, didn't anticipate. I thought we would have seen the mark on the barrier. I didn't expect to see the barrier to be, to shuffle back. So it'll take a number of minutes for the track to be cleaned. The issue is, what do they do with this barrier? Do they leave it, or do they put a tire bale in front of it, or... They've got to get this car also removed. Fortunately, there's a gap to get the car back into the pit lane and get it clear of anything on circuit.
So there is the car, unfortunately, of Vincent Abril down there in the concrete barriers after collecting it, unfortunately. And a lot of damage for the WRT team to get on top of. And we can hear from Pierre Dudonné, the man in charge of WRT.
Pierre, that was something you didn't really need at the start of qualifying.
No, it is the way to win a title, I'm afraid, yeah.
Is he okay?
It seems. We don't have a lot of information, but yeah, from the picture we've seen, it's okay. It's a big impact, of course. We expect the car to be quite extensively damaged, but that's the way it is.
And do we know what caused it? Was it an error? Was it the conditions, a failure? Do you know yet?
No, we have no idea, but usually in condition like that, it's very treacherous and it's probably just a driver mistake in difficult conditions. That's what we assume, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Not being drawn on much there, Pierre Dudonné, but as he says, not the ideal way to go about winning a title. In fact, I interviewed Vincent Abril yesterday, and you can see that in the top of the show in the races tomorrow, and he says all we need to do is be sensible, don't go out there and stick it in the wall.
Listen, you don't go out there being anything else other than sensible, but you're a racing driver, you're looking to try and improve your lap time as much as possible. Maybe this incident all started as a consequence of coming through the final little left turn 11, right turn 12, where we've seen a lot of drivers shortcutting it, particularly on the entry to that, but also some on the exit where there is one of those sort of sausage-style curbings. If you catch that and it sets the car off on a sort of a massive tank slapper. That combined with probably still slippery track conditions, damp offline, and out of control, that's all it takes. But I can guarantee you, nobody sets out to go out and have an accident in any form or other during qualifying, practice, or a race.
24 points is their advantage over the Silver Cup pairing of David Fuminelli and Stefano Colombo, and there are 34 points available this weekend. So it was always going to be a tough ask for Fuminelli and Colombo, but it may have got a little potentially more realistic, but still a long way to go. 2 1-hour races to come tomorrow as the marshals get to work removing the car from the obviously dangerous position, and the one that it can't remain in. And they will clear that WRT Audi, that very sorry looking WRT Audi. Vance van Abril's had a very impressive season here. Mateusz Lisowski finishing on the podium at the very first race of the season in Nogaro. But let's turn our attention back to the action we're going to be seeing out on track. There are two cars waiting at the end of the pit lane. It's Alex Zanardi and Maximilian Goetz waiting to head out there onto the track. And there is Zanardi, who has been very quick this weekend so far.
I mean, he's been absolutely magnificent. Be it wet, be it dry, he's absolutely just loved being here in Baku. And I think, talking about his background and his growth in motorsport, street tracks were something that he seemed to excel on. This is a quick road track more than a street track, but he's just dialed himself into it and loving it.
There is the view down Mikhail Husanov Street. And then they turn left and exit out onto the dual carriageway once again. We had Frederik Vervisch go into those tyre barriers in free practice one this morning when he just went in a little too hot into that right-hander of turn eight. And there you can see the ginormous Azerbaijani flag. And you can also see where the chicane was last year, just there on that shot, where it cut right and then left. And now it's a straight-on blat down the hill towards this hairpin, which has also been reprofiled this year. It's a lot tighter and therefore quite a few more possibilities for overtaking. Now let's hear from Jeroen Bleekemolen. He is down in the pits with David Addison.
Jeroen, a big weekend this for the championship, and here you are with changeable conditions and now a red flag. Hard to get into a rhythm.
Yeah, I mean, I just hope it doesn't start raining soon, because then it's a bit of a lottery for everyone. We were just betting the brake, so Harry didn't even put a lap in yet, so we're nowhere at the moment. But it looks like it might stay dry, so then I'll push very hard in Q2, and hopefully that brings us into Q3, and then we try to finish the season with a good qualifying.
But the temperature is pretty cold, so it's not easy to get the track to dry out. It's not easy for the tyres to get any temperature either.
Yeah, it's tough. I mean, the walls are right there. If you make a small mistake, the weekend could be over. But you have to give everything, because it's a tough field with lots of quick teams, drivers, cars, everything.
And what's the plan for the weekend? Is it to go out and win races, or are you thinking about points and therefore playing it safe and no damage?
No, the only thing we can do is try to win the race, which is in this field very tough. But I feel we have a good car, and in practice, we were right there. I think also now in the races and qualifying, we should be fine unless it just starts raining now. But our car usually likes when it's a little bit slick, a little bit slippery, and you have slicks on the car. So hopefully that will help us and gives us a good starting position.
But with you needing the points and needing to win, a downside of this huge entry this weekend is that other people can arrive and take points away from you, maybe.
Yeah, it's much harder to win than normal, because we have 10, well, I think about 8 or 10 cars that are really strong with factory drivers, or at least very, very quick drivers in their cars and good teams behind it. So it's a great battle, but it doesn't make our life easier here.
Good luck.
Thank you.
He's absolutely right. Some of the additional entries are stunning.
I mean, it's a great entry. Of course, these cars can come into play and they may interfere with the battle for the position in the championship. Interestingly, just on the TV screens, we were getting notification that cars that shortcut or abbreviate the chicane, which is principally down at turns 1 and 2, where we saw a number of cars making major errors under braking, and also on the return leg through 11 and 12, will have their times deleted. I think that says it all.
Yep, absolutely. So
that's a heavily damaged car. The more you see it, the more you realize just how much damage to the right-hand side there is. But it's only when the car gets back into the garage and the engineers get to work on it, get the body panels off, the suspension off, and get to have a really good look primarily at the chassis itself to see whether there's any damage that is unrepairable, which would be a great shame indeed, or is it just going to be an all-nighter? But the right-hand side, and I think it was the right rear that, you know, took the brunt of the impact, the right rear slammed into the concrete barriers and the front swung in and gave it a sort of a side slap.
So, not looking particularly good. So we've heard from your own Bleaker Merlin. Now we can hear from Maximilian Gertz, the man leading the Blancpain Sprint Series.
Max, a big weekend for the championship, and now a tricky track and a red flag.
Yeah, it's happened. I thought it's coming earlier, to be honest, because the track conditions are really not easy. The Indian line is dry, but anything else, it's wet. And as soon as you come over the line, yeah, you are off because it's no grip anymore. So I expect, to be honest, a red flag, and it's happened.
So this must be really frustrating. You want to be out there and have the track time, and here you are sat in the pit lane, tyres going cold.
Yeah, it's true, but it's for everyone the same, you know. So now we got prepared now to go back on the track, and hopefully I'm the first car to have a free lap just directly in the beginning, and I want to improve my lap time because I know there's something, some room to improve.
And around here, overtaking perhaps will be difficult, so the higher up the grid, very important.
Yeah, and Zolder was also difficult to overtake, and we did it in the end. We overtook a lot of cars, and we finished the race first. So, yeah, everything is possible, especially here. Everything can happen. We try to stay concentrate till the end, and we need some points in the end, and we will hopefully we will get it.
The Lamborghini is the big threat for the championship. What about for the races? Where's the race opposition coming from?
Yeah, Jerome was fast this morning in practice, so he's always fast. So he's the big man to beat. But all the others are also quick. So we have to stay focused, do our job, and take not too much risk.
And are you thinking race wins or points?
Points and hopefully also a podium. That would be great.
Good luck.
Thanks.
So Maxi Gertz, the man leading the championship by 27 points. There is the front right of Vincent Abril's car, and
yeah, that's
a pretty sight.
Pretty ugly, you have to say. I mean, once they get the carbon fiber panels removed and they get into the damage, is it superficial? I mean, lots of these parts in these cars are engineered that they, when they're in impact, they depart from the car, and that helps dissipate the energy, and it helps hopefully in not letting that damage pass all the way through the key parts of the chassis. And obviously, the work going to be trying to get this bit of concrete, these slabs, I think they weigh about 3-4 tons a piece, get it back into position, get the debris fencing in line. So this could take, and we're just seeing the pit lane, there's the Audi is driven back. We're seeing the driver's side, not the passenger side. There's the passenger side. You can see the missing right rear, which was somewhat further down the racetrack. Let's wait and see what the engineers and the team say, whether they feel that this is something that they can recover, bearing in mind their position in the Silver Cup Championship, that they will do everything, I'm sure, that is possible to get this car available and ready for tomorrow.
So the next job is to straighten out the barriers there at the final corner, and then we should be getting, hopefully, back underway with qualifying here in Baku ahead of the final race of the season. We just heard from Max Gertz, the man leading the championship. And we've got a new entrant this weekend, a man we're all familiar with, Alvaro Parent. He's with Bytec this weekend, and now he's with David.
Alvaro Parent, another weekend, another circuit, another McLaren, another team. How does Bytec and how does this circuit compare with the rest of the year?
Yeah, it's always a special event, isn't it? It's the last one. A lot of cars here. It's a great show. You know, a lot is involved. Everyone wants to finish the season on a high. Joined Bytec again, as I did last year for the last race of the GT Open Championship, a different series. And happy to be with them here. First two free practices, we had a good free practice one. Free practice two wasn't as good as we expected, but, you know, it can all change in a city track. You want to be there, you want to be on track. You don't want to have these bad moments that unfortunately just happened. But we're looking forward, and we'll see what happens. Philippe's doing all right, and anxious to get on the car for Q2.
When the McLaren first arrived on the scene, it always looked like it was a fairly tricky car, certainly for the AMs. I know it's different for a pro, but in these conditions, is it a really difficult car to drive because of the power coming in, or is it not too bad when it's this greasy?
I don't like to say it's a difficult car to drive. It's very interesting, you know, it moves around a bit more, but it, at the same time, it's stiffer, feels nice. It's a proper race car. No, yeah, but I can see that the car, we fixed that already this season and last season, so and now looking forward for the next season, you know. But it's a little bit tricky, mainly on brakes, but we're on the right path, and next year you'll see that it's going to be good. Fingers crossed.
Okay, now around here, really your car, the focus is going to be when you're behind the wheel because you're the quicker of the two drivers, but how easy is it going to be to overtake and make progress?
Well, we'll see. Qualifying still on, you know, we don't know what's going to happen. Fingers crossed we're right at the front, you know, but it's hard to overtake on a city track. But as you saw, remember last year, there was a lot of change of positions and a lot of things happened. You have to be on track, be on the right moment, have a good stop. And we'll see. For now, we're going on the right direction, and we'll see Q2.
Good luck.
Alvaro Parent last year for Sebastian Loeb Racing got spun around at turn three, and so he knows that it's difficult to defend at a street circuit as well. So we're about to get qualifying back underway here, and with about 40 seconds to go before the start of the session again, and it's only going to be 7.5 minutes, so these guys are only going to get a lap or two in.
Well, the fact they're going back out, the tyre temperatures have dropped away, maybe tyre pressures dropped as well. The track has not fundamentally changed in any sense because you've got the dry line, which we can see, but the off-line part of the racetrack, you can see there in the pit lane is wet. Now, that's because it hasn't been used very much. There have been other events on track here over the last three or so hours, which has contributed to the track getting a dry line. But it just shows how marginal that line is. If you are on a set of tyres that has not reached temperature and you push too hard, or you stray offline, or maybe, as in the case of coming through that little left-right chicane, which may have had water. Chicanes and little humps like that, they do retain water. It gets on your tyre, the back end just snaps out of control, and that's then the pinball effect as you bounce off the barriers and come to a standstill with a very heavily damaged car.
So we've got 7.5 minutes left of Q1, and then we move to the 15-minute Q2 session, and then the fastest drivers from the two sessions will go through to the top 15 shootout. It'll be this weekend because it's half the amount of cars that get to go through to the final Q3 segment of qualifying. So it means the battle for pole position will be relatively clear traffic-wise with 15 cars, but into that is going to be the challenge.
Remember, 15 cars is, on average, five more than we're accustomed to in that final shootout. And it is on a street track. I mean, I think there's a number of places here where overtaking is possible. But in these conditions, as we are right now, nobody wants to go offline. And if you're a car that is about to be overtaken by a competitive car, unless you're on an in-lap, you're not going to concede ground. So it's going to be a frustrating session for everybody going out now. Just 6.5 minutes remaining. So you can do your out-lap. That's going to take you an hour, a minute and 40, 45 seconds. Look at the pace the cars are being led round at. Everybody's trying to find track position. And all they're doing is just bunching up behind each other. And this is just going to add to the frustration of everybody who that group of 8 or 9 cars coming through turn 8.
So this is the final chicane and then out onto the start-finish straight again. So who's going to be the first car to come across the line and start a flying lap? Well, here is one of them. It's Harry Prochek in the 28 Grasser Racing Lamborghini. We heard from your own that he had only been bedding in his brakes. That's all he'd done. And so he hadn't actually set a fast lap. And as a result, they are 24th in the standings at the moment, but now Prochek's behind the wheel and starting to go for it.
And most importantly, he has got a clear road ahead of him. He hasn't got anybody he's pursuing. There's nobody pursuing him, so he can focus on what he has to do, and that is to maximise the potential of that Lamborghini. We know it's a quick car in Harry Prochek's hands, even quicker in the hands of Jerome Blakemolen. And assuming that Harry Prochek has no problems, you would expect to see that car very comfortably, very shortly in the top 15.
Into the right-hander, up near Mikhail Husinov Street, out into the old town, and then up to the tight left-hander of turn 7.
You need to be very cautious here because you can overrun so easily, lose all the time, all the effort you've built up, then the short squirt it is down to turn eight, back onto the dual carriageway. Better to be slow on the entry but strong on the exit than the other way around. And also by doing so, you're going to minimize your prospects of ending up in the barrier on the outside. Now flat out down the hill through turn nine.
Just a little lift as he came through turn nine. Not 100% confident just yet, Harry Prochick, and he's gone in.
Too deep.
Pretty deep into the hairpin of turn 10. Then back out on the return leg now, back towards the giant flag that is pretty close to the start. Finish straight here in Baku through the chicane. Attacks the curbs and then into the final corner of 13. Again, a feathering of the throttle all the way around and across the line to do a 1 minute 36.674. And that puts him up to 11th place, 2 seconds slower than the quickest time, which is still that of the Schubert BMW of Jens Klingmann.
Remember, this is his first flying lap. And the previous best lap was done by Klingmann on his third lap. So he'd have had two flying laps plus the one out lap. So Harry Prochick has got scope to take another second or maybe more out of his time. I mean, going through turn nine and coming back up through turn 13 in dry conditions, those should be comfortably flat.
Here comes Kelvin van der Linde in a new entry for this weekend. Is he about to go quickest of anyone? He's just set some good lap times and it's second quickest behind René Rast, who is the quickest man of all. And van der Linde, who's with the Prosperia Apt Racing team, is and partnering Christopher Meese in that squad, is certainly a man to watch out for, the young South African. But I'm surprised they put René Rast out in this first session of qualifying. Normally it's Enzo Eat that goes out first, as we now watch Cesar Ramos down at the hairpin. Purple in the first sector, personal best in the middle sector.
Yep, makes the climb all the way back up. So he'll come up to this little flip-flop left and right chicane. Not as aggressive as we saw in the morning session when the track was bone dry. Everybody a little bit more respectful as they come into turn 13. They've seen what can happen if you lose it. If it goes wrong, it'll be big. So good run from Sergio Ramos. Wait to see what that time.
Seventh place.
Well, that's probably slightly disappointing, bearing in mind he was strong in the opening part of that. Now, look, lights flashing, traffic. Everybody's either falling back to make space or trying to bully their way through with the lights go flashing.
René Rast actually was the fastest man of anyone in that first sector. There he is, and he must have run into that traffic and had to get out of it.
Yeah, I mean, simply there's no point in wasting tire or time. He's letting even, I think it's the Zaxby that is, the Mercedes-Benz, the blue and white, just giving himself space, knowing what he's got to do, and he knows he's got the speed in the car. As we go back to the 777, or 76, is the
Jens Klingmann,
the Schubert BMW.
Also looking quick at the moment is the 36 Schutz Motorsport entry, which at the moment is in the hands of Martin Raginger. And that's the car he's sharing with Marco Holzer. He's gone purple, and in fact, he's just gone to the top of the timing screens. The Porsche, quickest, flying over those curbs, goes the BMW now of Klingmann, currently third quickest, only personal best, not best of anyone. He flashes across the start-finish line, but it's enough to put him back to the top of the timing screens by almost half a second.
And half a second quicker than the best we've seen at any point during today's running, so that's a strong performance. Dominic Baumann, he's happy with that one. One thumb, only one thumb, Dominic. I think it's better than that.
Here's Max Gertz, currently in... Where is he? Well down the order at the moment. 17th place. Is he about to improve on that? He's done personal best in sectors one and two. Oh, had to get on the brakes there.
He got way, well, he certainly got out of the throttle. He got way, way wide up to fourth place on a 32.469. But he sort of got too wide too early in the middle of turn 13 and a big lift to check the car to bring it back into control.
Still makes his way up into fourth position though, Max Gertz. As we now look at this 777 Audi again in the hands of Kelvin van der Linde, the young racer who has always raced with VW, so sticking with the VW Audi group and now moving with an R8 with Prosperia by Apt Racing.
Again,
oh dear, and that's
13.
Mark Basseng.
Again, same thing. Earlier in the corner than we saw the incident earlier on of Vincent Abril. And that, and Nicky Meyer-Mellenhoff in the pits, sister car, Basseng again in turn 13, coming into turn 13. You can see what's happened. Skid marks coming from the left of the track across.
That's an odd one, isn't it?
Well, again, I think this is the exit of coming out of this chicane. I think that was the same issue. It may not have been...
Well, again, Basseng's climbing out, which
he's getting
good
out. I mean, that's radiator steam, so there's nothing to worry about. But again, another Audi. I don't know why. I haven't seen what the cause, I've just seen the consequence. red flag again. The session is going to be deleted. I mean, it's over now.
Yep.
But again, almost at the same part of the circuit, a bit earlier in the corner, two Audis off. I can't imagine other than just maybe being too aspirational or ambitious coming through the chicane. And there is water held within the chicane. Whether that's caused it or not, I don't know. But certainly, it's more than coincidence.
Yep. Well, we'll wait and see. It's good to see, though, that Basseng is out of the car, having had quite a sizable impact down there. There is his former teammate, and teammate still at Phoenix, but in the sister car of Marcus Vinkel.
Skid marks starting. They're coming. That is from the exit of the chicane.
So he's taken too much curve, and it's got away from him.
In my view, looking at the skid marks, I think it's been this thing of shortcutting the chicane. They may not agree. Certainly, Marc Basseng could tell us himself. But that's all I can think. There's no other logical reason. And you can see the car's just gone sideways and caught the barrier beyond the protection at the pit-in exit. Unfortunately, he hit the barrier further down, not on the pit-in exit. It would have been much more severe if it caught the tyre bales, because that would have been a much more abrupt stop than having the car bounce off the concrete barriers and then continue to slide down the track.
So, that is the end of the session, which means that the quickest man in Q1 is Jens Klingmann, the German driver for Schubert BMW. Martin Raginger, second quickest in the 36 Schutz Motorsport Porsche 997. And there you can see Jens Klingmann. Good drive from him to go just under half a second quicker than anyone else out there on the circuit. But it will be interesting to see whether we get quicker times in Q2. In theory, we will, because the track will continue to evolve.
Yeah, but we're going to have to wait to get the track cleared up, and you know, this is going to take a little bit of time. We lost, 15, 20 minutes with the original incident. Gets dark here around about 5:30, 6 o'clock. We might have a bit of nighttime running here if we don't get through these three sessions without further interruption.
Kelvin van der Linde was on for a very good lap. He'd just done the fastest middle sector of anyone. Also, Daniel Kielwitz had just done the fastest first sector of anyone. But they couldn't beat Jens Klingmann, the quickest man of anyone in Q1. Let's hear from him with David.
Jens Klingmann, 0.4 quicker than anybody else at the end of Q1. Great effort. Well done.
Yeah, it's my first time here in Baku. And my first time I'm racing in the Blancpain GT Series apart from the 24-hour race. So everything is new for me. I know the team from GT Masters. I know Dominik Baumann. He's a good friend of mine. And I'm quite happy. I didn't expect it, because at the first free practice we were struggling a bit, but still was on pace. And in the wet, I was hoping it gets dry for the qualifying, because in the wet we were struggling quite a lot, in the heavy rain at least. And so now everything worked out perfectly, and I'm really, really happy as well for the team.
How hard was that session with the interruption early with the red flag and then the second stoppage? Was it hard to get into any rhythm?
Yeah, for us, it was quite easy from the beginning on, let's say, because the performance was there in the car. And I knew, okay, if it goes on with the second part of the qualifying, we can continue like that. And we had a good pace in the first stint, let's say. And but of course, you think in the pit, okay, maybe it stays red, and maybe we can cancel the session because you're on P1. And you know, okay, the others are coming. And in the end, it worked out. I pushed every lap to the maximum because I knew 7 minutes, maybe a yellow flag. And then you're out again, and now a bit of luck is necessary for the success, and we had a bit of luck, and so we're standing in the first row.
We've seen a lot of damage in that first part of qualifying. What is the track state like? Is it very slippy?
Yeah, it's very slippy, but this morning was also very slippy. And with the rain, there's one dry line, and you have to take this one line, and it's difficult, because if you overpush the car a little and then you end up on the wet spot, then it's very difficult to hold the line in the end, because there's, as I said, in the end, it's one line. And as I said, we managed to take this one perfectly.
A great job. Well done.
Thank you.
So Jens Klingmann being quickest doesn't count for anything at the moment. What will happen is if his teammate doesn't go as quick. Well, let's have a look at a replay here.
Well, this is the BMW coming out of...
This is Klingmann.
Yeah, this is coming out of turn 10, the climb up the hill. So let's have a look and see what he is doing going through this little flick left, flick right. We'll be cut back now to Maximilian Gutz.
But yeah, just to finish off that point, if his teammate doesn't go as quick as that, and that is one of the top 15 quickest times, then he will get through to the final segment of qualifying. But we tend to see the top 15 cars coming from Q2, but maybe it'll be different here with such a big, busy grid and ever-evolving track conditions, as we have an ever-evolving clear-up operation down at the entrance to turn 13 after Marc Basseng's accident has brought a halt to qualifying here. And you can see a few scrapes around the place to be expected, really. Max Buch was quite proud earlier. He said, after 5 minutes, I'd already lost my wing mirror. That's how close to the walls I was going.
Look at the amount of shifting of the concrete blocks again. I mean, there are four of those blocks that have been basically dislodged from their original position. And that's what the hydraulic jack there is going to try and get them back into position, as they still have got, of course, to get this Audi of Marc Basseng back onto the back of the flatbed truck. And it's just time passing by.
Yep, it's now 20 to 5 here in Azerbaijan. We've got both races coming up tomorrow at 9 o'clock local time is the first qualifying race, so make sure you join us for that, and then that'll decide the grid for the main race, which is coming up later on in the afternoon. And it's those two one-hour races that will decide the Blancpain Sprint Series champions of 2014. Will it be Maximilian Goetz, or will it be Jeroen Bleekemolen and Harry Prochek? Race gets underway, the main race, at 2 o'clock tomorrow afternoon. So we'll be going on air at about 1:30 with our live pictures.
And but the what we would call the sprint race, 9 a.m. Do you think back 1 year ago at 9 a.m. you could have skated around the racetrack?
It was a month later, though, and
it was
December.
But still, ice is ice.
Ice is ice. Ice, Watty. And there we can see Steph Dusseldorp sat at the wheel of his HTP Mercedes, getting ready to head out into the second part of qualifying. There is Marc Basseng trudging back down the paddock just in the middle. He's the man with the helmet in his hand, walking over towards the... He's about to go through the puddle and head back to the Phoenix Racing Garage. And you can see his sister car there waiting. And is anyone going to come and greet him and say, oh, don't worry, Marky?
Well, it's never a nice situation to be in when you've had a major off, your car's heavily damaged, and you know, you're going back to basically say, sorry, guys, I made a mistake. And it's not just the mistake. The amount of time available from this session concluding and then the first race on Sunday morning, you're looking at probably the best part of 14 hours in reality. And you've got two Audis that need major, major reconstruction.
There is Jeroen Bleekemolen and Harry Poshik's car. It'll be Jeroen Bleekemolen taking to the wheel for the second segment of qualifying. And it's all about being in the top 15 and getting through to Q3, which is just a 10-minute session in the pole position shootout at the end of what in theory is a one-hour session. But we might be hanging around for a little bit longer than that, I think, today. And here's the chat between Vinky and Basseng.
Just snaps. He just said it's the back end just broke away.
Good German.
I mean, I understand international wrist flick.
Yeah. Well, let's hear about it in English, shall we? He's down there with David Addison.
Mark, first question. You okay?
Yeah, I'm okay.
What happened?
I just went a little bit too wide over the curb, and the car, on the moment it was landing, it just turned to right. So, yeah, that was the weekend, because the car is too heavily damaged to repair.
So that's the end. That's the weekend finished.
Yeah, weekend finished.
Great shame. Thank you, Mark.
Still he and Alessandro Latif, the Pro-Am champions of 2014 in Blancpain Sprint. They wrapped that up in Zolder, but not the way they wanted their season to finish. And I don't know if a hug from Nicky Meyer-Maroff has ever made anyone feel better.
Well, no, it doesn't, but it's nice that there's one member of the team that's actually come up and said, look, mate, you're all right. Look, it's a motor racing accident, nothing more, nothing less. I think Marcus sort of summed it up by saying, using the curbing in that turn 11-12 chicane, if you're too aggressive, especially going through the slightly more sausage-like curbing on the inside as you exit, not only is it raised and it makes the car, it throws the car, but if there is water being held in that, it can just simply be as little as water getting onto your right tire that causes the loss of traction. And once it's gone, because the tire temperatures are low, track temperature is low, coefficient of grip is low, and you're going to have a big slide. You may miss something, or you hit it, in the case of Marc Basseng.
Here's a look at the results after Q1. Jens Klingman, the quickest of anyone in the Schubert BMW. Martin Raginger, second quickest. René Rast, third for WRT Audi. Max Gertz, only fourth quickest. Kelvin van der Linde in fifth. Daniel Kielwitz in sixth. Then we've got Alan Day and Andreas Simonsen, seventh quickest in the... The name escapes me. Zaxby, that's it, of course. They have a good run from there. Marc Basseng and Alessandro Latif, 13th quickest, but Basseng reckons that's his weekend over. Harry Prochek finishing 15th, but it'll be Jeroen Bleekemann going out in the car for the second segment of qualifying, so expect them to climb up the order. Same as well for Johnny Adam and Andy Suchek, expecting more from Suchek, perhaps, in that Beechstein Aston Martin. Alex Zanardi only 21st, but he'll be out in Q2 as well. All 30 cars took to the start of the session, but that 29th place number 4 car, the Audi of Vincent Abril and Mateusz Sosowski, ended their session early, and still troubles to Stefan Landman and Thomas Pavoda. A real shame for the Grasser Racing team there, because they had to withdraw from the second race at Zolder because of engine damage, and just so they could be ready here. Looking back at some of the highlights of that qualifying session, this was Nicky Mayer-Melnoff getting on that wet patch and sliding away from the apex down at the hairpin at turn 10, got on the throttle and booted it back going again, and I think he stuck his hand out the window there. And then we saw Vincent Abril ending his session, potentially weekend, against the barriers, and quite a hefty impact for the Frenchman. That brought our first red flag of the session. Vincent was okay. Then the cars headed back out for the second segment of qualifying, and there was the accident for Marc Basseng. Can't quite catch it, but a hefty impact as he lost the car over the curbs. It flicked away from me. But there is René Rast, who's confused to be on television. But now let's hear from the Zaxspeed Spider, Andreas Simonsen.
Andreas, are you looking forward to this session? Because there's been so much damage, are you a bit nervous?
No, we're looking forward. I saw there was a bit of wet patches on the track still, but it will be... will be fun.
Is this a track you like?
Yeah, after the changes they made from last year, I think this is a really fun track now, and it's a lot of fun, and I hope I will do a good qualifying, and then I maybe will feel better.
We'll leave you to it. Have a good session.
Andreas Simonsen.
Yeah, it's interesting that, you know, racing drivers love a challenge, and the big difference with this sort of racetrack is you've got concrete defining the limits of the track. Most other tracks that we race on around the world are permanent racetracks, where you've got wide open spaces. And it just re-emphasizes the difference that coming to a street track, and this is a fast street track. Turn 13, or the approach to it, is quick. So if you get it wrong, the impact on the outcome is going to be severe.
Just to quickly reflect on the accidents, if Basseng feels that that's his weekend over, you have to fear for Vincent Abril's car.
It depends the angle of attack and the barrier, whether that has translated the impact all the way through the chassis. If that's the case, then they'll not be racing tomorrow. They may be lucky that a lot of the impact might have been taken with the suspension, the wheel. The wheel came off the rear. That sheds a load of energies. So until the team get all the irrelevant bits stripped down, and they can actually examine and measure suspensions, components. The thing you mentioned about Landsman in Zolder, you said the engine damage was caused by a driver error going over the chicane so severely that they cracked the engine, cracked the gearbox, cracked the chassis. Driver error.
These drivers, they're the biggest problem, aren't they, John?
Well, they're the most expensive part of the problem.
So, let's focus now on the second segment of qualifying. It's all about getting into the top 15 over both Q1 and Q2 in order to progress into Q3. And the quickest time we saw in that first session was a 31.591. Really, you need to be in the mid to low 32s if you want to be progressing into Q3. So we'll wait and see whether the pace is quicker in this. In theory, you have the quicker drivers out there with lighter fuel loads and a drying and evolving track that's getting grippier all the time. But we'll wait and see as they come around the left-hander and across the line. And it is Jeroen Bleekemolen, the first man out there onto circuit, down towards turn one, unchanged from last year. And he flicks it through, takes a lot of that blue curve on the inside. We go on board down to the hairpin.
Yes, now you're going to see a professional driver at the top of his game, in clear air, nothing to worry about ahead of him, nobody behind. Well, there is actually a car ahead of him, we didn't quite pick that up early enough. Probably just as exited the pit lane prior to him coming through the exit of turn 13. And hopefully, mirrors will be used. You buy the things when you buy the car, hopefully they will be in use.
up towards. Oh, Lee Kamona, he's not stopping there.
No, no, no. What did he think he was doing? That was so blindingly obvious that there was no way he could do that.
And there's Harry Prochek, nervous in the garage, because if he had such a difficult run in Q1, it means that he is going to, if Bleekemolen doesn't get into the top 15 here and set a good lap time, then he's going to be in a lot of trouble. Now, Bleekemolen is heading up, presumably to do a Yui.
I don't know where he's going.
I don't know where he's going either.
He's been sent up sort of
turn 8. He's going to rejoin the track.
At turn 8, so he will be very careful, because cars will be coming from his right just beyond there. We see where their cars, actually not a bad plan, but of course he's lost now effectively not only the lap he was on, but the lap he would have been going on to, plus time. We're down to about 11 and a half minutes, and I do not understand what Jerome thought he was doing.
So there goes Bleekemolen back into the session, and I did wonder where he was going for a while there, but he knows the places to go.
Yeah.
And Bleekemolen's back out there. He's still got the fastest first sector of anyone.
Yeah, but I mean, for a driver of his knowledge, experience, a schoolboy error. Something you would do in a car track, Jack. Car track, Jack.
Let's have a look at the replay, John.
Car ahead of him, coming into turn 4.
No, he locks up.
Well,
locks up. These cars have ABS.
That's the reason he locked up. The
but
car ahead of him.
These cars have ABS.
You can adjust the ABS. You can have it adjusted to whatever degree you like. The front wheel's locked up, which is not normally what you expect. But he was focusing on the car ahead. He was already in the inside. Well, what he was, I do not know. I'll have to talk to him later.
Here is Laurence Vanthor, who's set the fastest time in the first sector, but I think he was backing out of it as he came out of that corner. I'm going to be proved totally wrong now as he comes through the middle sector and goes pretty quickly, about half a second down, but he is still quicker than Mateusz Stump, who's the man who has set the quickest time of the session so far. So Vanthor starting to push. He knows that he needs to win the race and hope that Max Buch doesn't finish particularly strongly if he wants to take the overall Blancpain GT Series title. He's already the Blancpain Endurance Champion, is Laurence Vanthor, as he comes out of the final corner, across the line to go quickest of anyone. Because Dominic Baumann immediately follows through in the Schubert BMW to go quickest. So that car is looking very, very strong indeed.
Yeah, it's a very quick car. We've seen that. We saw that in Slovakia in particular. That was a dominant car. Now the problem for everybody is they're sort of equidistant spread around the circuit, 15 cars, and you're always going to find somebody somewhere, either on a way out.
Meese.
Yeah.
He was going super fast. Fastest first sector, great middle sector, ruined it.
Yeah, simply just misjudged it, outbraked himself. Now he's backed off. He's got Barry, I think it's Jerome Blake and Moulton coming up behind him. Hopefully that's not going to interfere with the Lamborghini's lap. Comes through 12, 13. Oh, and look, absolutely right up against the wall.
Yep, down is comes Stefan Ortelli into the hairpin of turn 10, currently 10th quickest overall. Bleekemolen goes second quickest, a 32.168. So we're still out of the final corner. Any improvement from the Porsche? Yes, but he remains in third place, a 1 minute 32.075. Just 0.07 of a second behind. Now here's Andy Suchek lobbing it through the final chicane and around turn 13. And he has done very, very well in the first and second sectors. Any improvement from the Aston Martin? Quickest, a 1 minute 30.850, 0.6 quicker than your own Bleekemolen.
And quickest again all weekend by half a second.
Wonderful lap from Andy Suchek. We go on board with the Spaniard, the former Formula 2 champion, down towards the hairpin. But here's
Dominic Baumann has gone second by only a tenth of a second to the Aston Martin. Now Jerome Blake, he's backed out. No, has he backed out of it? Just trying out of turn 8. Sometimes the car looks like it's slow on the exit. In fact, just the camera angle doesn't give you an impression of speed. Little error down there. No.
Stefan Ortelli. I think he was making his way past the Zach Speed Merck.
Yeah. Just he got caught in that traffic in a very difficult. Oh, another accident on the exit of turn 13.
That's the Fortec car in the hands of Benji Hetherington. And
red flag.
He's lost a bit of the rear of the car and a bit of the side of the car, so I'm not quite sure where he's.
Same place, exit of turn 13. Topped and tailed it.
So the red flag is out here in Q2. This isn't even the battle for pole position, and it's still incredibly exciting. Joe Osborne's done a great job in that 888 BMW. He's up to 11.
Watch it, here he comes. Oh, there he gets it. Back end, gets away. Now that's much, much later in the corner. You're almost out of it, but if you're out wide as he was, that's dirty bit of racetrack. It's not wet, it's dirty. Look on board, coming through.
With Zanardi.
Oh, this is, okay. Yeah, it's hard to pick it up. We didn't quite see the beginning of it, but just he was too far out to the right on the dirty bit of track. The back end snapped and hit the barrier, popped the boot lid. The front then turned around and smacked the barrier. Three out of, well, I hope they don't change the chicane at turn 11 and 12, for they can't really do it. All they can do is put tire bales to try and slow on the apex, slow that corner down.
But it's by the time they're getting to 13, isn't it? And I appreciate that they'd have less speed there, but it's the wet, it's the conditions where, well, you know, it's slightly damp offline.
I don't think that was the condition. I think that was the track is dirty on the outside. It may be marginally less dry, but it certainly wasn't wet. And I think that's just because the rain has been falling midday, early afternoon, the track gets dirty again.
So look up to the top of the shot on the right-hand side as the car comes in.
Back end, there we go.
He arrives sideways.
Back end, as I suggested, and then the front slaps into the barrier. So he's lost it. He's got a tank slapper coming out of that little chicane. He's gone one way. The car's bitten back, hit the barrier with the left or the right rear. There we go. That's it. There it is. Yeah, you see how much dirt there was there? There's nothing damp. That's just dust.
Yeah.
Shouldn't have been out there in the first place. Too late to tell him in the second place. And in the third place, Trevor Foster is going to be very unhappy, I can tell you. Team manager of the Fortec team.
And there was a look on board with Alex Zanardi of Benji Hetherington. And there is Benji out of the car, which is good to see, as we have seen with all the incidents so far. But he knows that that's not the ideal way to start the weekend. Hopefully the Fortec squad can sort that out, because they did lose a car earlier in the year. They were initially running with two cars in Blancpain Sprint, but one car got written off.
Yeah, that was a front-end damage to the particular car. This has really slapped the rear right corner, and then the front got dragged in. So, I mean, it'll be suspension. Maybe the diff in the rear might need to be looked at. It would need to be looked at. Same in the front. But the front doesn't look to be too severely damaged. It's more superficial. It's the back of the car. Let's look again from this angle and see what happens. The back gets away. It's not that bad. I mean, that's repairable. That's repairable.
Go and help him
body,
out.
Bodywork. All you want is a checkbook, isn't it?
So there is the accident for Benji Hetherington, making his way back after making his return to Blancpain Sprint in Zolder last time out.
Do you know what? You can see the right rear, actually. The suspension is damaged.
Well, we can hear from Johnny Adam, who's the car that is the quickest car so far in the Aston Martin. He's with David Addison.
Johnny, this is looking pretty good for the Aston, isn't it?
Yeah, stunning lap from Andy there. Yeah, we've made a few adjustments from free practice to qualifying and really paid off. And low fuel, new tyre on for Andy, and stunning lap. You know, to put a 38.8 on the board there was stunning.
But I suppose he's got to be careful of the weather and the wall and also all the traffic.
That's the thing, yeah, busy track, and obviously the circuit is dry now, but offline, well, you can see there, you just can't get a foot offline, and hopefully that'll be enough to get us through to Q3, and yeah, we'll give it a go later on.
Now, you've got to work with a new co-driver, haven't you? Normally you're in British GT with Andrew Howard. Here we are, two pro drivers. That must be great for you, because you have a really good chance of a win, or at least a podium.
Yeah, I mean, we've done Zolder and got two fifths, which was great to meet Andy, get to work with him. And for him to drive the Aston, that was his first event, was driving the Aston. But he's very quick, you know, you can see that by the lap time. He's raced here last year, and he's a very good teammate to have on board.
Is he bringing things to the party as well? I know he's normally a McLaren driver, but he can bring, I would have thought, other ideas.
It's experience as well, you know, he's had 2 or 3 years now in GTs. And yes, the McLaren, there's little things that, you know, the McLaren's different on, but obviously the detail he has from driving the car has really helped our understanding a bit more on the Pirelli, etc. So it's really helped.
Excellent. Johnny, well done.
Thank you.
And I think the other thing, of course, is that, I mean, Andy Suchek jumping into the Aston Martin, which we saw a fortnight ago in Zolder, is that it is actually a much more compliant car for a driver to handle. You've got a much wider window to play with in terms of the forgiveness of the car.
Yep, absolutely. And that's an interesting point that Johnny Adam made about the Pirelli tyres as well, because Suchek's been racing on them in the Blancpain Endurance Series these last couple of years, and in British GT they're not on Pirellis, so that's another element that, that the teams have got to get used to.
Well, the suspension of the tyre, the way the tyre interacts with the suspension on a car, it is an independent suspension on its own. And when you're running on a spec tyre in the British GT Championships, on the circuits that everybody is so familiar with, and then you put a set of Pirellis onto your car, it is a relearning curve, and some of it may mean adaptation, mechanical changes to the car to get the best out of the tyre on your car. And Andy Suchek, who's got a huge amount of experience with the Pirelli tyre in a number of GT cars, and just, you know, he's a young driver who's coming to that zone where he's at the top of his game. And also racing on circuits outside of Great Britain is quite different. This is a great street track, but there's no room for margin or of error at all. And we've seen three incidents, all caused by driver error, in some cases by experienced drivers.
Well, thank you very much for sticking with us. If you're still here watching qualifying ahead of the final round of the 2014 Blancpain Sprint Series season, we've got a red flag after an accident for Benji Hetherington, the third accident of the qualifying session so far. We've got 6 minutes and 13 seconds left at Q2, which will restart in 30 seconds. But before we get session back going, let's hear from Richard Westbrook.
Richard Westbrook, this is turning out to be a very lively qualifying period, isn't it? With red flags, quite a bit of damage. What's it like out there?
It's tough. It's really tough. Well, most of the circuit's fine. It's just this long, sweeping last corner. There's one line through it, and depending on what car you're in, I mean, for the Porsche, you like to turn in nice and late, but you can't do, unfortunately, because there's just one line. And you put one wheel on the wet stuff, and then you're just understeering into the wall, which I think you've seen three times now. So it's not great for our car, but I think we're good for the top 15, and hopefully it'll be dry by then, and then we can get the final corner flat.
There's only one line at the moment around here, and if you step off that line, you're going to be in strife. How hard is it getting through the traffic?
It's, at the moment, you couldn't overtake in the race. I mean, you've just got to find a gap, which is not easy on a street circuit with 30 cars. You've got to be clever, and you've got to be patient. And it's hard work out there, but it's good fun.
The level of competition this weekend is perhaps fiercer than ever all season. Is that helping to contribute to all of these dramas? People are having to push that bit harder, too hard maybe?
Yeah, people are going for the championship. People want some money in their back pocket for Christmas, me included. So yeah, everyone's going for it. I mean, you know, why not? But, you know, if you make a mistake on the street circuit, especially here, then may as well go straight to the nightclub.
Good luck, Richard.
Typical of Richard. You know, he is actually a professional chef. That was one of his pre-motor racing things, always thinking of the Christmas turkey.
Exactly. And 5 minutes to go. Don't really know where to go with that one, John, so we'll carry on with the motor racing. 5 minutes to go here in the second segment of qualifying. It's all about getting into the top 15. Then we will have the 15 cars doing a pole position shootout. And so this is your last chance, really. Who is sort of looking unusually uncomfortable? Not that many. Christopher Meese, who's down in 21st position at the moment overall. That would be a surprise if that 777 car, the Prosperia Apt Racing machine, couldn't get through. Andreas Simonsen down in 19th as well. Kevin Estra and Rob Bell currently only 18th overall, but the majority of our championship challengers are up there and looking reasonably solid. Andy Sujek has headed out onto the circuit. Dominic Baumann and Jeroen Bleekemolen in second and third places at the moment haven't gone back in.
Look, you can see as they approach to turn 11, they're different. There's that browny colour on the right hand, on the left hand side of your screen. That's the danger you've got to worry about. It's not the wet. There's no wet on this corner now at all. It's the brown where the dust has been pushed offline, principally during the first session of practice here earlier today. And that's what's catching, certainly that's what caught out, without doubt, Benji Hetherington as he threw the car into turn 13.
It looks as though Dominic Baumann and Jeroen Bleekemolen are going to remain in the pits. They feel comfortable that they have done enough to get through to the pole position shootout, because they are the only two men, except for Lucas Stoltz, who also hasn't headed out there, and he's down in 13th place. So that's an unusual one, maybe a problem out there for Lucas Stoltz. But Baumann and Bleekemolen happy to stay in the pits for the time being as we watch Maximilian Buch, currently in 8th place, 1.5 seconds down on Andy Suchek.
He needs to get this car into that more comfortable zone of the top three, top four, because then when they go into this final shootout for qualifying to ensure that they may not have a car which is as quick as the Lamborghini of Jeroen Bleekemolen and Harry Prochek, but they need to make sure that the Lamborghini doesn't steal a march, and they get caught in the midfield battle, and consequently be focused on that and let the Blekemolen Lamborghini run away.
Absolutely. There are 27 points separating the cars and 34 points up for grabs this weekend, including 1 point for pole position. So it's going to be a big ask for Blekemolen and Project to close it in. But as we saw here last year, and as we've seen, you know, throughout the history of motor racing, anything can happen. Here comes then Marco Holzer, who is up into fourth place with that first flying lap out there. So that's a good run from Marco Holzer. He deposes Stefan Ortelli, still 0.6 of a second slower than Andy Suchek, who really is turning into a bit of a mega, you have to say. Really impressive drive from Suchek. But 2.5 minutes to go on the clock, and you can see we've got a reasonable amount of cars out there. Only three cars, so six cars not on the circuit. So we've got 24 in total as the Russian GT car lets people through.
Trying to get out of the way, and just a whole field of cars coming through as we get another glimpse. We need to see what... There we are, coming down the hill into turn 10.
That is Stefan Ortelli.
On the brakes, and the Monegasque, who will run the car out to the wall. Let's have a look and see. Now, this is the Russian, and did it smack the wall? It did indeed. Headlight, and he got away with it, but there's damage. That's why he's limping back to the pits.
Alexei Vasiliev, who had...
How did you do that in the exit of turn 9? Nobody's been out in that territory. It's like he's been digging potatoes or something that far off track.
Fastest middle sector for Giorgio Pantano in the Bytec McLaren. That would be great to see Bytec fighting at the front. They've had such a difficult season after stepping up from the International GT Open, getting used to the Pirelli tyres that they haven't been using before and getting used to the pit stops that they haven't been doing before. But Pantano's actually come into the pits at the end of that lap, so maybe something went awry in that middle sector. But we are watching Laurens Van Thor, who's currently down in eighth place, a 31.806, which is quicker than his teammate managed. And so that is enough to see him through at the moment. Alvaro Parenz just jumped up into eighth position, in fact, and pushed Van Thor down to ninth.
We don't need to mention it, but everybody now running with headlights on. There's nothing indicating that's a requirement, but it's an indication that the levels of light are dropping. And we've got, 50 seconds of this session remain.
Alex Zanardi could be in a bit of trouble. He's down in 13th place at the moment. The Italian, who was the quickest man in Free Practice 1, second quickest in Free Practice 2. And to have him not making it through to the top 15 shootout would be a surprise. Max Bucher's just jumped up to third quickest. Ricardo Spedafico, one of the two Brazilian twins who were sharing the number 20 car, is now up into fourth quickest. Your own Blekemolen and Dominic Baumann still in the pits in fifth and second, respectively. And there's a bit of understeer from Van Thor.
Well, he was on the brakes. You could hear the screeching of the tyres as he went into turn 10, and that was just a little bit too much pace. Couldn't keep the car checked, so he just stood on the brakes and got it to turn in. Now he goes on, he'll get this lap. Let's have a look and see what time he is going to do. Currently in 12th place on a 31.8. And he improves up to 8th place, 31.5. But he lost maybe a couple of tenths of a second. And again in the Audi pits, Van Saint-Vals, you can see the tension.
But he'll be happy with Stefan Ortelli, who's now gone... Oh, look at that.
Is that Ortelli or is that Voss? That
is Van Thor.
Is that Van Thor?
But Ortelli's just gone third quickest. There is the 33 Zanardi. Car of Alex Zanardi. He's done a personal best in the first sector. We go on board with him. What's he going to do in the middle sector? We'll get the timing up as he comes across the line now. It's a 34.8, which isn't particularly strong. So Zanardi might be struggling to get through to the top 15 here, which I think would really disappoint him. We've heard from him after the first couple of practice sessions, and he said when the track cleans up, then we might be in a bit of trouble. But there is the Brazilian BMW currently up there in fifth place. So through the final corner comes Zanardi. Is it good enough to get him towards the top 15? Across the line he comes.
Yes.
Sixth place.
Good job. Well done, Alex.
Across the line comes Dusseldorp. And he remains then in 16th position. So that second HDP car struggling a little. Van Thor jumps up into 10th position. So not quite the speed I would have expected from Laurens Van Thor. As we now see Stefan Ortelli skip over the curbs. Personal best in the first sector. Middle sector was sort of not very good, actually. So I'd be surprised if he improves.
But he does.
Up into second. A fantastic sector.
He releases the car midway through the corner and runs it right out over that. And I'm not sure whether that's actually a potential penalty, because that's a demarcation line and you're not meant to be over that into the really dirty bit of what would be not normally seen as racetrack.
there is the 777 car of Christopher Meese, who did manage to get him into 12th place overall. Soon we'll have confirmation of the cars that have gone through to the top 15, but currently the timekeepers are adding it all up and amalgamating the two session results. But certainly through is Andy Suchek for the Beechteen Aston Martin. A really wonderful drive from him. And what a great battle that was for that fight to get into the top 15. And if the pole position shootout's half as exciting as this, then it would have been worth the wait.
Yes, and Andy Suchek keen to get out of the car as the engineers are putting the dollies under the car to twist the car around and push it back into the cover. And it'll be Johnny Adam back into... No, it'll be Andy Suchek will stay in it.
Here's a look at the results then after the second segment of qualifying. The Aston Martin vantage of Beechteen AMR, Johnny Adam and Andy Suchek, the quickest in that session. Stefano Telli with a late lap, sending him second quickest, just in front of Dominic Baumann, who decided not to head out again. Frederic Vaviche up into fifth place in the Boots and Gignon McLaren. That's a really good run from Frederic Vaviche. Van Thor finishing fourth, Max Buch in sixth place. The two Spedaficos in seventh, eighth for Alex Zanardi. Jeroen Bleekemolen gambled a little in not going out in the remainder of that session, but it's worked out. He is through to the top 15 pole position shootout. Then we had Holzer and Siedler and Meese completing the top 12. Again, these are not the exact times and the exact cars that we'll see in the top 15 because they need to be aggregated with the first session time. Fuminelli and Colombo there in 15th place, and things could be looking good for them as far as the Silver Cup is concerned this weekend. Rob Bell and Kevin Estra only down in 19th place. René Rast may have done enough to be down in 20th place with that, 1.3 seconds down on the leader, a 32.2 for Enzo Eid, whereas Rast managed a 32.307. So yeah, so Eid was actually quicker in that one. And then 30th place, Stefan Landman and Thomas Pavoda. And those are our runners. And Pavoda did manage to get out in that session, but only did three laps. So that's a real challenge. So we can now hear from Andy Suchek, the quickest man of all. He is down in the pits with his Aston Martin and also with David Addison.
Andy, well done, a great lap, but the hard work really is still to come.
Yeah, exactly. I think Q2 is important just to get into Q3. But the most important is to try and be on pole for the third qualifying session, which is going to be very, very tight. So let's hope I can do a good lap like I did now and at least be in the top five, which is our aim.
For somebody who's only racing this car for the second time, you're driving it like an expert.
Well, I think I got used to it quite well and I'm enjoying it, which is the most important bit. The car feels good. Aston Martin is doing a great job and they made me feel like a family since the beginning. So we work well together and it seems to be working.
And what's the track like?
The track is good now. Actually, the grip is better than expected. On the new rubber, it was impressively good grip after the rainy conditions. So pretty well. I'm happy with everything.
Great job so far. Now go and do it all over again. Thanks, Andy.
So very happy, Andy Suchek. Those Q2 did end up being the quicker of the two sessions. So the top 15 in that second qualifying segment were the top 15 and are the top 15 that will go through to the pole position shootouts. And there we can see Andy Suchek, who's got to be one of the favourites for the front row.
Very much so. And I mean, a few people will be disappointed that they didn't make it into this top 15. But Andy Suchek, in what I would call a very compliant car for these kind of track conditions, the car, it may not necessarily be softer in the actual road ride, but in roll, it looks like it's working. And that's what helps on a relatively low grip, albeit more grip than they had anticipated, racetrack. And of course, confidence comes with grip and performance. And Andy Suchek, just over a tenth of a second faster than Stefan Ortelli. But Stefan Ortelli was running it out to the ragged edge, and where he could exceed it, he did. Now, that's not the racetrack.
It was a few hours ago.
It might have been, but that's actually directly behind us. This is the part of the port here in Baku. As we look at the... that's the Ferris wheel.
So,
a big, big, big port. The city is... people, I don't know what they think where Baku is or how big it is, but it is big.
And it is in Azerbaijan.
Most of it is, yes.
So we've got... 1 minute to go until Q3 starts. The 10-minute session that will decide pole position for the final. qualifying race of the season, which starts tomorrow, and then we will, that leads into the final main race, which is tomorrow afternoon. And those are our two championship contenders in that order, Max Buch and Max Goetz. It's Goetz leading the championship, and then behind him it's the Grassa Racing Lamborghini of Jeroen Bleekemolen. And they are getting ready to go out and do battle over pole position. There is the car of Marco Holzer and Martin Raginger, and it is Martin who is going to be taking part in the pole position shootout. You can see Marco Holzer helping him to get strapped in. Just 15 seconds to go. The light going down here in Azerbaijan. The light's coming on here in Azerbaijan, and this will be a spectacular way to end the session. And I think I remember we had this last year, didn't we, with qualifying? It went into this sort of dusk and everything looked awesome. So let's enjoy.
It is a great venue for a dusk evening race. We didn't expect it to be finishing at this time of evening, but due to the delays and those three red flags in that first session.
So the cars heading out onto the pits. David, do you have some news?
It's just one of those little quirks, Jack, of a wet day in Baku, because when you were talking about Holzer and Raginger helping one another to complete the pits, aspects of it was that Marco Holzer was wiping the base of the shoes of Martin Raginger, because of course your feet get slippery, you don't want to fall off the pedals, so one of his jobs wasn't just the seat belts, it was wiping the base of his feet as well.
Well, all I can say, David, you've got your racing boots on in the pit lane, don't slip up, it is slippery up there.
9 minutes to go then in this 10-minute session as the cars head out onto the track. And there in car number 16 is Frederik Vervich, who did a great job to get through into the final segment of qualifying. Lights ablaze on these cars now as Jeroen Bleekemolen turns through the left-hander of turn 7 down towards turn 8 that takes them out back onto the dual carriageway. But the first man out there is Max Goetz, the man leading the Blancpain Sprint Series Championship by 27 points. If he can grab pole position, that'll go up to 28 points with just 33 points remaining, which means they could, they still could wrap it up potentially in the qualifying race tomorrow if problems befall that 28 Lamborghini.
Well, we've had three red flags in one qualifying session. No one anticipated that, as we see the Lamborghini weaving its way up the hill. Try and get some more temperature into the tyres. I'm never persuaded about the benefits of doing it. But with, what now, 8 minutes of the session remaining, everybody's going to stay on track until the end of the session. The point of coming in would only be if you had a brand new set of rubber and all you were doing is just checking this track. It can't have changed in the 10 minutes that this session between session two and session three. So we go on Max Goetz.
Down towards turn three. This is the man who battled with Sebastian Vettel and Nico Rosberg in BMW ADAC about 10 or 11 years ago now, and he says the competition here is just as tough. And he comes up now towards the right-hander that takes him out onto Mikhail Usunov Street. Sparks flying from underneath that Mercedes as he climbs the hill past the hotel on the right-hand side, then up towards the 90-degree left-hander, gets on the brakes, turns it in. On board we go. He's got the pub that he's passing just now on the right-hand side, and then he heads out onto the dual carriageway again. So his first sector time in that 84 car is a 32.481. The Jeroen Bleekemolen car has done a 31.927, but the quickest man of anyone in that first sector is Alvaro Parent. So this is going to be a very, very interesting session.
Well, darn interesting. The brakes glowing red. You normally don't see that in daylight hours, but they're very clear indeed, the carbon fiber discs on the Mercedes. So the climb up the hill up to this notorious turn 11 and 12, which has called out three drivers so far in one session. So Maximilian Goetz gets the car ideally placed and swings through the corner, but you can see the sparks again on the outside of the car as it rolls, slightly cambered at the exit of this corner. Jeroen Bleekemolen chasing him down the hill.
And he's a second quicker at the end of that first flying lap, Jeroen Bleekemolen. A 1 minute 31.4, quickest time we've seen, a 30.8 from that man, Andy Suchek, in the Aston Martin that flashes underneath us on the run down towards turn one. And it's Alvaro Parent who's the quickest man of anyone, a 31.0. But Laurens Vanthoor has gone purple in sectors one and two as well, as we watch him coming out of turn 10.
Well, how familiar are we seeing this, Laurens Vanthoor? putting together faster sector times after sector times, goes through the notorious turns 11 and 12, now has to sweep through turn 13, comes across the start-finish line, should be taking provisional pole, maybe a high 1 minute 30, what, middle 1 minute 30, 0.495.
Phenomenal lap from Laurens Vanthoor as he moves into provisional pole position. Still 6 minutes to go here. That's the WRT team looking on. And this is Frederik Vervich turning right through turn eight. Out onto the dual carriageway again. He's gone quickest of anyone in sector number one, Vervich. He was here racing for Boots and Gignon last year. He's been impressive in the Blancpain Endurance Series. And he is now looking very, very strong as he comes down through the middle sector at 34.4, so a tenth or so down now on Laurens Vanthoor. Stefan Ortelli has just jumped up into second quickest, so we've got Vanthoor and Ortelli, the two men who won here last year, in first and second at the moment.
Yeah, but the gap is a 0.4 of a second. Whoa. So when it, how quick was Vanthoor through there? That was commitment. Can he carry the speed all the way through and make sure he finishes the lap? Looks a good lap. He's done it, 30.219.
Wonderful final sector from Vervich. Flew across that chicane as though it wasn't there. But Vanthoor has just gone quicker in the first sector. Bleekemolen is still third as far as the championship battle concerned. And Max Gopes is down in seventh place. This is Alex Zanardi, a 31.9 in sector one, which is a good 0.6 of a second down. His middle sector is coming up now at 34.7, which again is about 0.7 of a second down. So Zanardi not particularly on it on this lap as he tries to get the power down. Vanthoor's gone purple in sectors one and two though. So Laurens Vanthoor might be jumping back to the top of the timing screen. Zanardi throws it through the chicane. This is only going to be good enough for sort of a fifth to eighth place at the moment for Alex Zanardi as he comes through the final corner across the line with 4 minutes to go. And it's only 11th. For the Italian at the moment. Vanthoor goes quickest again, 1 minute 30.071.
And Ortelli looking, Ortelli's now using almost everything but the racetrack coming through the chicane as the Brazil BMW comes through compete. Here is Ortelli, and what's he going to do? He's going quickest, 30.033, and he's straight lined that chicane. Look at the brakes. I mean, everybody's just doing the same thing. They're cutting the inside of that chicane. Literally to straight line it.
Bleekemolen's lost about 0.3 of a second in the middle sector though in that Lamborghini as he flashes through the chicane. Will he be able to improve? He's currently in fourth place. Frederik Vervich is now up into third position. What's Bleekemolen got across the line? No improvement. He remains in fourth position. So it's Ortelli, Vanthoor, Vervich, Bleekemolen, Andy Suchek in fifth, sixth for Dominic Baumann, seventh for Martin Raginger, eighth for Max Gertz, ninth Alvaro Parent, tenth is Norbert Siedler, Vandelin, Zanardi, Winkelhock, Spedafico and Colombo.
This is a slow-ish lap, a relatively slow lap for Laurens Vanthoor. Cesar Ramos, his teammate looking, yes, Cesar Ramos watching. So Vanthoor is going to come up, he's going to get it again. So the current lap he's on will be a slow lap in relative terms. He has got, well, this lap, one more lap after this lap to wrestle that pole position away from Stefan Ortelli, who was mega through turns 11 and 12.
Yeah, wonderful stuff from Ortelli as Vanthoor gets on the brakes then into the first chicane, using all of the road and a little bit more on the exit of that chicane. Meanwhile, this is Andy Suchek, who's currently in sixth place, but he's just done a personal best in the first sector, a 31.6, which is, 31.3, which is less than half a tenth of a second slower than the fastest first sector time we've seen so far. So this is looking strong for Andy Suchek in the BC in Aston Martin. He goes flat out through the long right-hander of turn number nine, down towards the hairpin at turn 10. What's the middle sector looking like? It's a 34 is a good time.
2 tenths down.
Oh, but
he's
gone deep. Too deep.
Lost it. He's got one more lap, though. He did all the hard yards till he got to turn 10. Just overran on the brakes. Couldn't slow the Aston down. Watch him through the chicane. Aston is probably the best car through there. The least amount of disruption to the chassis. Suchek currently in seventh place. He still might marginally improve, but it's going to be... He dials up to fifth.
Still, despite that mistake, impressive stuff from Suchek. Bleekemolen is up to third now, just a tenth and a half behind pole man Stefan Ortelli. Max Gertz, the championship leader, is a second down in eighth position. This is Norbert Siedler now coming through the final corner in the Porsche. He's in 11th place at the moment. He's done a personal best in the first sector, and that moves him up into ninth spot. So eighth and ninth at the moment for the two Porsches, and it's shoots ahead of track speed. A minute and 20 seconds to go, and Stefan Ortelli has just done a slow first sector. So will he be able to get around in time in order to do another lap? This is Dominic Baumann, who was in up to fourth a moment ago, but he's now slipped back down to sixth place. Car 28, your own Bleekemolen, went across the chicane at turns one and two. And that may well be his last chance at climbing up the order. This is nevertheless with Dominic Baumann. Pounds the curves.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable through that curve. Carried so much speed. This should see an improvement from sixth place for Baumann. It does. It goes up to, well, then he stays in sixth place.
Yep, so
130.374, an improvement in time, but not in position.
Our championship leader, Max Gertz, in 10th place at the moment. 30 seconds to go. The spark's flying off that Merc as he gets so close to the wall. Is it an improvement? Yes, but only up into 7th position. Kelvin van der Linde has just done a personal best in that first sector in the apt Audi. But who else is out there that can do anything about Stefan Ortelli? Not many people. Van der Linde is looking strong. And of course, he will get another lap in there, will Max Gertz. But this, Van der Linde won't. Van der Linde won't be able to do anything about it. His session is over, yep. And that is a real shame. That's up at
turn seven.
And that's going to affect the other drivers with yellow flags as well.
Well, I think they managed to get it pretty much under control. As we go back down to turn 10, Laurens van Thor had been looking reasonable, but not on that last lap. It was about a hundredth of a second. In fact, van Thor has gone into the pits. He's decided to call it a day. Front row of the grid alongside Ortelli.
Bleekemolen is 1.5 tenths down on Ortelli, but has just done his personal best in sector one. The championship challengers are not going to go out without a fight. Van Thor's come into the pit, so has Norbert Seidler. This, meanwhile, is Spedafico coming around the final corner and across the line to jump up into 10th place. But what is Bleekemolen doing out there? He looks like he can be the last man that can upset Stefan Ortelli. Here is Bleekemolen through turn 9. We're going to get a good look at his middle sector split. A low 34 is what we want. A 34.3 in the middle sector is okay. But it'll have to be something mega through the final two corners if he wants to take provisional pole.
He's going to struggle to get onto the front row of the grid because he's a tenth and a half behind Van Thor in second place. Still doable. He's just got to be perfect through the final little chicane and on to start finish straight through turn 13. Takes the flag, remains third.
So it's Stefan Ortelli who will start on pole position for the qualifying race here in Azerbaijan tomorrow. That man there, Maximilian Gertz, pulls into the pits. The championship leader will start seventh on the grid with his main championship rival starting in third position. There's 27 points between them with 33 points to go. So they only need, they've got that 6-point margin that they need to achieve, which they could do in the qualifying race tomorrow, but it's going to be tough. There then is our pole position man, Stefan Ortelli. And John, in a massive grid, loads of entries, young chargers like Laurens van Thor, Andy Suchek, but it's Stefan Ortelli, the experienced man who has taken pole.
It's experience, but what it is mostly is experience racing between concrete barriers. He's got so much years of experience behind him, having raced and road tracks all over the world. He used that experience to maximum effect. Took a big risk coming up the hill here through 11 and 12. Straight lined it literally there. He had barely two wheels on the racetrack, almost all four off the track in the air. And that's where he carried all the speed all the way through turn 13. And that's how he ended up on pole position.
Well, what a frantic pole position shootout that was. It was 27 minutes late in coming to you after a couple of accidents, but we got there in the end. And goodness me, wasn't it worth it? And if the races are half as exciting as that, then I'm going to need a new throat tomorrow afternoon. We can now hear from Laurens van... Well, there is van Thor anyway, praising Stefan Ortelli as he comes past. They won the championship together last season, and now we can hear from Laurens. He's in the pits with David Addison.
Laurens, second fastest. Good session?
Yeah, good. I've just beaten by my old teammate by 300th of a second, so if there's one guy who deserves it, it's him, so a good friend, so.
Stefan, what a lap, well done.
Yeah, it's a great car. I mean, last year we were also very enthusiastic about this track. I mean, the layout of the track is really, really good. It suits the Audi as well, pretty much. Well, I mean, it was a kind of lap you were dreaming about. I think we are working a lot in the team. You know, we have a lot of fast drivers at Audi WRT team, and it's also helping us because in between every stop, we actually talk about the car and the way to drive. these young guys, they push me a lot, and I learned as well from them, like they are learning from me. Plus, we have a very, very good car. I'm happy.
How tough was that? Because we've had the stoppages, the light is going, it's cold, it's still greasy.
I didn't see that much, but the car was really grippy on the track. That's the most important thing.
Well done, Stefan.
1998, Le Mans 24-hour winner with Porsche. Porsche Super Cup champion in 2002. Fast forward 12 years from that, and he's still racing, and he's still one of the quickest guys out there.
And the thing with Stefan Ortelli is he is passionate, his middle name. He is so passionate. He loves his motor racing. And you know, to go out on a track that has been very difficult for everybody and give that kind of performance, Laurens Van Thor, who normally is the Audi driver who just sticks it on pole position, to do so and beat Laurens Van Thor, that's a great accolade for Stefan Ortelli.
We can now hear from your own Bleekemolen. Third place, was that the best he could have got today? Let's find out.
Your own, that looks like a tough day at the office.
Yeah, I mean, in Q2 we had an ABS failure again, which is really tough on a street track, sure, because you don't have confidence in the brakes. So I had to go straight, probably screwed up one of the left front tires. Then Q3, the car was great. The last lap could have been pole. I was 1/10 up on myself. And then I had traffic, unfortunately. It's really unfair. I mean, I let the guy pass the previous lap, really fair. I just moved over on the straight, and he completely screwed me in turn 8. And this was, I did a 13.4. I think I could have done, you know, 30 flat or 29.9. So it's really, you know, it's a street race, and it's hard to overtake. Pole position means a lot, so I'm really upset with him.
But you're ahead of the Mercedes for the championship, so that must be the positive to take out of it.
Well, I didn't even think about that yet, but it doesn't matter. We just have to win anyway. So the mindset is all about winning this weekend. And when somebody really screws you, it feels tough, you know. It was in our hands. We had the car to do pole, even with the ABS failure, even without the full confidence. And to be screwed like that for no reason is just, yeah, on a day like this where, you know, it's big things at stake, it's just very disappointing.
Frustrating. Yeah. Well done, your own. And apologies for the colourful language of a disappointed driver.
Yes, apologies for that. And
oh, can I apologise as well for
him? No, go for it. Yeah, for it.
No, it's just emotion is so high. And frustration, you can sense that Jerome Bleekemolen. And I have to say sorry, Jerome, I got it wrong as well. And Jack, you spotted it. You said he locked the brakes up. I know there's ABS in that car, but the failure, and that's something that really is frightening for a driver. When you're so dependent on an aid to prevent lockups and you get it, it catches you unawares. So, Jerome, totally innocent, and I shot from the lip in that one, I'm afraid.
So, the sun begins to go down in the land of fire, and we can hear now from Frederik Vervisch. A great job from him, fourth on the grid.
Frederik Vervisch, that was a really impressive session. Great commitment over the curb and very fast as well. You must be pleased with that.
Yeah, we're really pleased because we didn't start really, really good, not really fast, all the McLarens. And I didn't expect before, and I think even we could fight for pole. There was really the potential, so that's really great. Now we have to see. Hopefully it doesn't rain because we are not so quick in the rain. So we will see tomorrow.
But in these greasy conditions, it's not too bad.
No, it's very good. I mean, the track is dry. It's, when you go offline, you can have a problem, like we saw. We're really we had some troubles, and everybody did a great job. So it's a good start, start of the weekend. So.
Yeah, the day didn't start too good for your car, did it?
No, it didn't. It didn't. Chris had a small late braking, and then we were just under the tires. No big thing, but well, okay, we lost some time, and also free practice too, but doesn't matter. The qualifying was good, so we're really happy.
Great job, well done.
Really was a great job by Frederik Vervisch to be fourth. The next McLaren is 12th with Alvaro Parent, the switch around of Pirelli caps, and that gives us a clue that Andy Suchek is the next man to be grilled.
Well, Andy, you did your best to replicate Q2, but it didn't quite happen.
I told you it was not going to be easy. I think I missed it by 2/10 or something, so it was very tight. And to be honest, my lap in Q2 was much better than the lap in Q3. Obviously, you run less fuel, so you expect it to be faster. But the guys in front did a very good job, and we are happy with the fifth position. The race is long. We have two races, and the important one is the last, so we'll see.
Track getting better towards the end of the day, or was it more difficult because it's getting a bit darker and a lot colder?
It was a bit of both, you know. The track was improving, but it was getting darker, so the visibility was not that good, but it wasn't really a problem for any of us, so I have to say that they did a better job. They drove a better lap, and that's it, but I think I had a car good enough for pole.
Andy, good luck for the races.
Thank you very much.
So Andy Suchek will start fifth on the grid for that one, and the top 11 cars in that session covered by 9 tenths of a second on a street track that takes about a minute and a half to cover. That's pretty tight in anyone's book.
A great intervention. I mean, one of the best qualifying sessions I think we've seen throughout the season, and the best one comes at the very end.
Absolutely. Sixth place on the grid will be Dominic Baumann. Let's hear from him.
Good day for the BMW, Dominic, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was quite okay. Free practice was perfect. Also the second one in the rain, where Jens a little bit complained. But now overall with P6, we're quite fine. More maybe in the last lap there could be one or two tenths, but I guess 5 tenths, it's not possible.
So looking forward to the qualifying race, what can you do from where you are on the grid? Can you overtake? Can you go forward?
Yeah, to overtake it's really hard, I guess. So the other one has to do a mistake or something like this. But in a normal way, it's really hard, and we give our best. And I guess there will be a lot of accidents, and try to stay away of the accident, and we are for sure fine.
You kept off the wall today. What's the secret?
I don't know. I really feel confident in the car. It's everything's perfect. So I'm nearly every weekend in the car. So, but also the track this year is for me much better than last year. I don't know. It's maybe some luck. I don't know.
Top job today. Well done.
Dominic Baumann there with a sixth place finish. And there is Alex Zanardi, who could only manage 14th place. The Royal BMW is finishing in 14th and 15th position. So it'll be interesting to hear Zanardi's thoughts and how he felt that session went, because he got through into the top six, I think he was, in the end, but he could only manage 14th place overall. Here's how the grid will line up. A WRT 1-2. Stefan Ortelli and Laurence Vanthoor, who won the championship here together last year, will start side by side on the front row of the grid. Your own Bleeker Molen will start in third place. Frederik Vavish will start fourth. Andy Suchek in the Aston Martin will start in fifth position. Max Buch and Max Goetz, championship leaders, down in seventh place. And then we've got the two Porsches in ninth place, and Benz doing a good job to end up 10th on their Blancpain Sprint Series debut. We can now hear from Alex Zanardi. There you can see him, 14th place. Let's go down to him now with David.
Alex Zanardi, what a day.
Yeah, I would have loved to finish my day the way it started, but I can't change it now. No, I'm very pleased and proud of the work that all the boys here at the Royal Motorsports team did. The BMW machine is a great car, and some of my mates proved it that it could have been higher in the grid. I think I had a shot at it, but unfortunately I experienced some brake problems throughout the session. The pedal was going long, and as a result of that I could not eat the tires properly going into the turns. On the last lap I just winded all the balance towards the front and I improved my first sector, and the car was getting good towards midway in the second, but then I got the yellow flag, so that was it.
Alex, good luck for tomorrow.
Thank you.
So 14th place for Zanardi, just ahead of his teammate Stefano Colombo. And it'll be interesting to see them out on the circuit later on. But what a qualifying session it was, John.
Yeah, I think very exciting, very tense, all the pressure leading up to it. Everybody felt that pressure. They all responded. Brilliant session.
So, as the sun begins to set here in Azerbaijan, let's have a little look back at that frantic session. It all started with Marc Bassin going straight on at the first corner. The first car out of the pits, Nicky Mayer-Manoff as well, was all over the show, not once, but twice, down at the hairpins. That time just running a little wide as he got onto the damp patch and booted the car around and got going again and gave a little gesticulation. But then the first of our accidents, Vincent Abril. We'll need to find out what's going to happen to that car, whether it can recover, because it hit the barrier at quite a speed, John.
Yeah, big, big slap of the barrier. You saw the right rear wheel rolling down the left-hand side of the track, right-hand side of the screen. And that car heavily damaged. We don't know whether it's going to be repairable.
Jens Klingman was very quick, but also then out of the race, out of qualifying, I should say, and out of the weekend, according to him, is Marc Bassin. Maybe the damage isn't quite as bad as he feared, but when he told Vinky what had happened, there was a certain amount of disappointment in the German's voice as the cars wound their way around. And then there was the ABS failure for your own Bleeker Molen, which meant he just locked up and went straight on.
Yeah, man, it looked like it was a bit interference from the car ahead, but as he explained to us, it was an ABS failure at a most critical point. The lap lost, then the lap he was going to go on to as well. because he had to rejoin late.
Andy Suchek was looking fast. Benji Hetherington was looking at concrete as he lost the back end of the Fortec Mercedes. That was the third and final of our accidents. Max Goetz and Maximilian Boot could only manage seventh quickest despite sparks flying. Oh, we did have another sort of accident as Alexei Vasiliev ran wide coming out of turn nine and clouded the wall, and Laurens Vanthoor got incredibly close to the wall as well. But Stefan Ortelli was the man who was absolutely on it as we went into the final top 15 pole position shootout, and it was ultimately Bleeker Merlin who ended up on top. But Laurens Vanthoor was looking quick early on, but a great drive from Frederik Vervisch.
Yeah, I mean, this McLaren has not been really performing in the damp conditions, but as the track improved, the grip levels came up and the strength of the McLaren came to the fore.
Your own Bleeker Merlin ended the session third quickest. Meanwhile, Stefano Colombo had to fight his way with Martin Raginger alongside, and then the 76 car of Dominic Baumann was looking quick, but Stefan Ortelli is the quickest man. He'll start on pole position for the main race tomorrow. Join us.